guys, welcome back. This is Professor Hank, and in this video, we're going to talk about parallel arrays. Okay, so parallel arrays sounds really complicated, but it really, it's pretty simple, right? So let's say that you've got a situation where you got a bunch of data that's related to each other, and you need to store it in memory somehow, right? So, you know, imagine a collection of records, right? A bunch of students, and each student has a name, a GPA, maybe their age, something like that. And you need to store data for, you need to store that data for each student. And let's say maybe you got 100 students, maybe you got 20 students. What do you do? Maybe, you know, one semester you've got 20 students, maybe the next semester you got 25 students, maybe the next semester you got 35 students. What do you do? Right? Now, student's name is going to be a string, you know, that's a string of data. Their GPA might be a floating point number. Letter grade might be character, right? So we got different types of data. I mean, you can imagine all the things, types of data that you might have to keep track of for a student. Right? So you got different types of data, you got multiple students. How do you keep all that stuff straight? Well, that's where parallel arrays comes in, right? So the ideas here are you use multiple arrays to store data that's related to each other. Right? Now, each one of those arrays can be different data types, right? Now, one array can only store one type of data, but there's nothing that says you can't use multiple arrays to represent these things. So for example, you can have one array that is going to be storing the student's name, another array that's going to be storing student's GPA, another array that's maybe storing their gender, right? So an array of strings, array of floats, array of characters, right? So, you know, you can just split up the data that you're going to be needing to store for each student in different arrays, right? Using the appropriate data types that you need. So how do you relate the data to each other, right? So you got one student, they got a name, gender, GPA. How do you specify, or how do you denote, or how do you make sure that all three of those pieces of data go together, right? For student John, for example. Well, use the subscripts. Right? So you'll relate the data by the subscript. So if you got those three arrays, well, make sure that the data for a student is all stored in corresponding elements in each array. So, you know, for John, make sure that his name is in element 0 of the strings array. If you have a gender array, make sure that his gender is stored in the gender array and in 0th element in the first element. You know, GPA, make sure that you store their GPA in the first element, the element with subscript 0, etc. Right? So anything related to John is going to have a subscript of 0 no matter how many arrays you need. Okay? So you can combine this idea with partially filled arrays to get yourself to a database, right? So you can say, well, we have this array that can store up to 35 pieces of information. Well, let's say I got four of them, you know, one for the name, one for the GPA, one for the gender, one for maybe their student ID number, whatever. I mean, whatever data you need. And so, you know, you have a capacity then with those four arrays, if they all are set to say size 35, you have the capacity to store up to 35 students. But remember, with partially filled arrays, you know, you don't have to use the entire array or arrays. Right? You can just use, you know, the first 20 elements of each of those arrays. So, you know, if you only have 20 students. All right, so let's look at a quick example here. And I'll stick with this idea of, you know, students, keeping student records, right? When you talk about records, you're just talking about, you know, a collection of data that is related to each other. So the record for a student, name, GPA, and age. There we go. We'll do that, okay? So if I'm gonna store students' names, then I'm gonna need a string data type. Okay, so let's use parallel arrays to store student records. Okay, and each record will have name, age, GPA. Okay, that's what we'll do. So let's go ahead and create those arrays. All right, so let's see here. Const int, I'll create a named constant called cap for capacity, and we'll pin that at, 35. Okay, and then from there, we'll go ahead and we'll create the three parallel arrays that I need. Right, I'm going to need an array for the students' names, right? And so initially that'll be empty, okay? And then I'll need an array of integers for the ages, okay? Initially it'll be empty, and by empty I mean I won't initialize it to anything. I mean, arrays can't be empty, but. And then how about GPA, which I'll make a float, okay? So I've got three different arrays. This first array is for storing the students' names, right? And this is for storing their ages. And the GPA, for storing their GPA, right? So what I can do then is, for each student, I might have the first student and everything related to the first student is going to be stored in element 0, right? So what we'll do is we'll say, well, names of 0 is equal to John Doe, right? And then ages of 0 is equal to 22, and then GPA of 0, maybe I should call this GPAs because it's plural, right? So that's what I'll do. GPAs of 0. John Doe had a 3.5. Okay, so that's the first student. Now, how about everything related to the second student? Right, that will be stored in element 1 of all the different arrays. Right, so I'll just copy and paste this, and we'll come up with somebody else. This will be Jane Doe. Right. Jane Doe is 23, and her GPA is 3.75, right? Now, everything related to Jane Doe is in subscript 1, right? So, subscript 1 is everything for Jane, right? And subscript 0 is everything for John. Right? I mean, and that's really all there is to it. I mean, that's what you're doing. So now, anytime you want to access John Doe's record, you just go to subscript 0, right? So maybe you ask the user, enter the ID number, right? That's what the 0 would be here. It would be like maybe their student ID number, or enter the subscript. We'll just use consistent language here. Enter the subscript of the student you want to view, right? Of the student's record, maybe. Of the student's record you want to view, right? So we'll let the user type that in, and I'll say sub for subscript here. Okay, and then cn sub, right? And so then all we have to do is print out all three pieces of information. So I could do something like see out the student's name, right? But that is going to be coming from the names array using the subscript provided by the user, right? And then we'll similarly do something for their age, right? And and then similarly for GPA, right? So all we're doing is we're taking all the information for a student, there's three different data types that we need to have, one for string, one for integer, one for float. And we're just putting each piece of information into an appropriately typed array, and then we're just making sure that they're all related, they're all tied together by that subscript, right? So let's go ahead and run this. Okay. Okay, so there we go. Okay, let me close that. Okay, and I'll close that. We don't need to see it. Okay, so enter the subscript of the student's record you want to view. Well, I want to see Jane, so I'll type 1. So what do I see? Well, I see Jane Doe, 23, 3.75. Why? Because sub had 1 placed inside of it, so names of 1 is Jane Doe, ages of 1 is 23, GPAs of 1 is 3.75, right? So that's really all there is to it. Now, what if I wanted to print out, what if I wanted to print out all of my records, right? Print out all the records. Okay, well then I can use a for loop for, I'll call this for int rec number, or I was calling that subscript, right? So int sub is equal to 0, so long as that is less than what? Cap? That doesn't make much sense, right? We'll come back to that here in a second, but I only got 2 records in right now, one for John Doe and one for Jane Doe. And so I'll copy and paste this here, put it into this, put this into the body of the for loop. Okay, so now what this is going to do, I'll go ahead and run it. Okay, that for loop is going to go through and loop through every single record, showing me the information for each student, right? So when sub was 0, I'm printing out names of 0, ages of 0, GPAs of 0, and there's John Doe. Sub gets incremented, go back up. Sub's now 1, so then we do names of sub again, ages of sub, GPAs of sub, but this time sub is 1, right? So names of 1 is Jane Doe, ages of 1 is 23, GPAs of 1 is 3.75, so we see Jane Doe's information, right? So it really is as simple as that. Use as many arrays as you need to store as much information as you need, and each array is dedicated to one field of the record, one piece of the record, such as name, age, GPA, right? Whatever you need. Okay. Now, I hard coded in 2 here because I knew there was 2 people. I didn't want to use cap, right? Because if I use cap, I'm going to have some issues, right? Because I only added data for elements 0 and 1 in all my arrays, right? I didn't add any information in all the rest of the elements, right? So there's the contents of all the rest of the elements of the arrays: garbage, 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 right? So no bueno. So this is where going back to and borrowing from the idea of partially filled arrays could be useful, right? Because you could have something in here like int last student, right? Or maybe last record or something, whatever you want to call it, right? Since we've got 2 students, right? Keep track of the last element, right? It would actually be 1. That would be the last element that actually has a student record in it, right? So the last record is 1, and this tracks the subscript of the last element with a student record in it, right? Or with student info in it. So now, instead of doing hard coding in 2 or putting in cap there, that named constant that's equal to 35, I'll just do last record, right? And then if you want to add another student, right? So we could say something like cout add another student, right? And you can imagine putting this in a loop or whatever you need, right? You could say, well, enter the student's name, right? And then read in their name. Or actually, we'll want to use get name here because was their first and last name. Get line, CN, and that would go into names of what? Well, right now, the last record has subscript 1, and we're using this to keep track of the last element that has valid student information in it. So let's make sure that we, again, increment that last record by 1. And so now last record will contain 2. And so now, if we do get line names of last record, right, then we're going to be reading into names of 2. Okay. So we can do that, and then we can say cout enter the student's age, right? And then we'll see in their age. Let's see here. See in ages of last record. Okay. And then we could say cout enter the student's GPA. Days, last record. Okay, one more thing we got to do though, because since we're using get line after a CN statement here, we got to put a CN.ignore in between because that new line character is going to be left over inside the keyboard buffer. So I'll just put it right here. And that'll toss that new line character. Okay, so this is how we can add a new record to our database. Okay. So let's run it. Oh, you know what? Forgot one thing. How about after we add the record, we'll go ahead and we'll print out all the updated records. Okay, so let's toss that in there. Okay, to show our new student being added to our database. Okay, so, oops, let's grab this. Okay, so let's take a look at this output again. Right. So, what do we have? All right. So, we got John Doe. Okay. And what's that the result of? This loop right here. But here's the thing. Forgot one little piece of information, right? So, it only showed us John Doe 22.3.5 because sub got started at 0 and then it went up to but not including whatever last record was. And last record was 1. So as soon as sub became 1, this evaluated to false, right? So got an off by 1 error here. You actually got to make this less than or equal to. Because we want to go up through the last record, okay? So make sure we do that. Now let's try this one more time. Okay, so there's our John and our Jane. Okay, now we're down here, right, where it says enter the subscript of the student's record you want to view, so I'll just put in 0. Okay, so there's our Jane Doe. Okay. So now we're going to add another student. So where we're at right now is right here. Right? So last record got incremented by 1. So now we're going to add that new student using the get line statement there. So we'll call this student Jimmy Doe, right? So now we're asking for the age and reading that into the array on line 63. So Jimmy Doe is 20, right? And then we're on line 66. What's Jimmy Doe's GPA? 1.9. Got to study harder, Jimmy, right? So once we've done that, then we kick down to our loop on line 70 here, a for loop, which is going to go through and show us, here's the output. Show us all of the items now in our array. So this first line right here, John Doe, accessing the names array at element 0, 22, the ages array at element 0, GPA, the GPA's array at element 0, and then the next iteration of the loop, Jane Doe is element 1 in the names array, 23 is element 1 in the ages array, 3.75 is element 1 in the GPA's array, and then for Jimmy Doe, which we just added, Jimmy Doe is in element 2 of the names array, age 20 is in element 2 of the ages array, and 1.9 is in element 2 of the GPA's array. Okay, so what we have in this video is a demonstration of how we can set up parallel arrays to store student records, right, using different types of data, utilizing this idea of parallel arrays, right? Then minded you or demonstrated that, look, you know, you just use the subscripts. First student's case is 0 and the second student's case 1 to associate the data with each other across arrays to relate the data together. That enables you to do cool things with for loops, going through and printing out all of the student's information, right? Going subscript, element by element, using the subscript, going element by element by element, allows you to, you know, do some lookups against your parallel arrays to specify, well, which record you actually want. Let's ask the user for it, right? And then also allows us to go ahead and add new information, borrowing from the partially filled arrays idea, to add new data to our little mini database.
Okay, so that's going to bring this video to a close. If you felt that the video was useful, please consider giving the video a thumbs up. And if you thought that the video sucked, well, then you've got that thumbs down button as an option as well. If you'd like to see more videos, if you're interested in more content from the channel, feel free to hit that subscribe button. And as usual, if you're a student of mine and you have further questions, feel free to drop me an email or to stop by my office hours. Okay, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.